Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today I will be telling you about all of the books I've read in November, which has been my worst reading month for many reasons, but I did get some reading done, mostly on the commutes and at lunch, and I didn't get any other free time to read, so that is why my reading is all over the place. So the first book I read was still kind of getting off the high of October and Halloween related things. So I read this book by William Hope Hodgson called The Ghost Pirates and Others. I was mainly interested in the ghost pirates, but this collection includes mostly nautical horror, which I did not know was a genre, believe it or not. I really love to read about pirates and I love weird fiction. So this was kind of a perfect hybrid of the two. Now, I found out about this book, like I do most of my, what have turned out to be some of my favorite books this year. I stalked this guy on Goodreads. Well, he knows who he is. He sometimes comments in this comment section too. And whenever he five stars something, I immediately no, I have to read it. Hodgson was a contemporary of H.P. Lovecraft's and Clark Ashton Smith's, and he kind of did a lot of sort of classic sounding literature that's very literary by our taste today, but at the time was a little bit on the odd supernatural sci-fi side. Kind of a classic in the weird fiction, and his work, The Ghost Pirates, is basically this journey on a boat where suddenly weird things start to happen and skeletal figures climb on board. It sounds a lot like the first Pirates of the Caribbean movie, but I promise you it's not. It's highly atmospheric and it has a more legendary tone. I don't even know how to describe this other than a very Victorian Christmas ghost story mixed with the first half of Moby Dick somehow, and told in this very beautiful narrative style that I really enjoyed. I would recommend this to everyone. It's just, it's kind of like suspenseful and horror in a way that you have to experience it. I would say this is more of an experience more than anything else. So I would recommend this for sure, and especially if you like pirates and a little bit of nautical horror. And if you know any more nautical horror, please let me know, because I just realized how much I loved the theme of this. So if you have any more recommendations, please link them down below. Then for nonfiction November, one of the challenges was voice, and I chose One Native Life, and this is the autobiography of Richard Wagamese. He has this incredible way of writing. You already know I've gushed about him on this channel so many times. I was a little bit hesitant to pick this up for a while because the word autobiography sometimes puts me off a little bit more, especially because I think authors try to present themselves in this very particular light and try to control their narrative that might not be entirely true. And I was scared that he was gonna start sort of David Copperfield style, like, I was born, you should know that I was born on this day, and then start from there. And instead, he sort of picks out moments in his life, things that had an impact on him. So for example, when he begins his autobiography, he starts with, my first memory of my father was when he took me fishing, and then he kind of talks about his relationships with people or with the land or with himself and his identity along the way. And I really enjoyed this biography style. I've never encountered it anywhere else before. I think it's brilliant to just pick out highlights in your life or kind of marking moments instead of trying to get all of the information on the page, because a lot of times, especially for readers, it's not all that interesting. Most people just want to know, like, that thing that you became famous for. Wagamese's parents went through the residential school system, and he had been thrown around from foster home to foster home until he eventually found the place he fit in. He had several marriages, and his life was just filled with ups and downs. He struggled with several addictions in his life, and throughout it all, he was also struggling to get back to being native, basically, and to understand what Ojibwe means and the stories, the traditions, the legends, the language, all of the things that had been taken away from him and his parents. In attempts to understand himself and learn more about his own perception and history and identity, he sort of goes back to the land many times, and he always reflects on that. So his autobiography was in many ways kind of nature writing as well as it was sort of reflective in many ways. I will definitely try to do an author spotlight, but I need to finish all of his books first, so hang in there for that one. Then also for Nonfiction November, I read this book, which kind of ripped a little bit. It's called The Dacian Stones Speak, and this is written by Paul McKendrick, and it's about Dacia. So Dacia was basically in ancient times where Romania currently is, and then the Romans came and won, and then they just kind of stayed, and then when they retreated from everywhere else, a lot of Romans decided to stay in Romania. The legends I heard say that they stayed because our women are just so darn beautiful and smart. This book was not what I expected it to be, but this is not the book's fault, it's kind of mine. So I thought that a lot of times it would kind of pull out like anthropological threads and kind of look at current Romanian traditions that came from the Dacians or things that kind of remained over time or like tried to weave in the present with the past and kind of give a sense of like how these things shaped Romania as it is now, basically. But instead, this was just as it is. It's an archaeological book. So it almost felt like you're walking through a museum and you're in that section with all the pottery and coins. And I'm not exaggerating, like there are pages where there's just, you know, here's a sculpture and then kind of dissect it in a very like purely archaeology kind of way. A lot of the history in this book was also Roman history, so it felt a lot like a classics course. Just a lot of dates though, and I wasn't a fan of all the like information dumps, you know, with a lot of dates and years and just a lot of dating. But again, it's an archaeology book, and this was my mistake, not understanding what it would be. It's very, very specific and niche of a topic. So if this interests you, of course, by all means, but I myself will probably be searching for another book on Dacian customs, maybe, or traditions or folklore. And hopefully one day I'll be able to find it. If you know of one, please let me know. Then I stepped away from it all for a little bit and I read The Enchanted. I know this was circulating on BookTube a few years ago, and I had it on the shelf for so long, and I finally wanted to get to it. The tone that this book starts with was perfect. There's a man, he's imprisoned, he tries to find the silver linings of being in prison, but he's not only in prison, he's on death row. So he knows that death is coming, he knows that this is all there is, for him at least, and somehow he still tries to make the most of it by using his very incredible imagination. And he imagines all of these things about the prison, about visitors and potential other inmates, every rock and every bar in that prison has a story attached to it. It's funny because there were a lot of moments where I kept thinking of Dostoevsky's House of the Dead, where he said that while in prison, a lot of people would just have nothing to stare at because there'd be just snow, a lot of sticks and stuff. So they would just kind of like count the sticks or count the fence posts or give them all a name or a story. So seeing this author applied this to the main character, it was just phenomenal, and it was kind of like magical realism in many ways. You felt transported. It was kind of like a person just digging through fairy tales to find solace for himself and to comfort himself. And I loved the places his mind went to. But then we have this lady who kind of prides herself on saving these people or trying to find their human side that society doesn't often see. And in this process, to try to figure out as much as she can about the prisoners. She favors this one inmate named York, and then the book kind of becomes about him. And from there, this book just took a total turn because it kind of lured me in with this language and magic and stories, and I was so hooked. And then it became about this inmate and all of the abuse that he's been through his whole life. But the way it started to be told from that moment onwards, it felt a lot like a crime novel or just kind of a detective, trying to uncover crime things. It felt like a show almost. It felt like two different books. There are twists and turns, and I'm not gonna spoil them. And after that, my mind split in a million pieces, and I got so distracted from everything, which was very unfortunate because I was also involved in three different buddy reads. And I am publicly apologizing to all of my buddy reading buddies that I'm so sorry that I didn't check in as often as I should have. I finished all three books. The first one I buddy read with Joe, and this is New Spring. This is a prequel to The Wheel of Time. We have now read five novels and one prequel, so six in total. And I'm going to check in with that book on the next Wheel of Time check-in. I'm not going to talk about it here. The second buddy read was How to Be a Victorian by Ruth Goodman, and this one I buddy read with Natalie from Curious Reader. I'll link her channel down below. This book we were supposed to read in October, but we ended up reading it now, and just like Halloween, it felt weird to read Victober things in November, and it got delayed many times. We loved this book. It was focused on fashion a lot, and Victorian fashion has kind of a thing of its own. I've discovered many new YouTube channels that kind of design Victorian clothing. So that's kind of been a good pairing with this book. Goodman kind of says, I went to the museum and I saw this blouse and I thought about it. Wow, like this was on a person. A person worked in this and sweats in this and lived in this. And she kind of then takes this and says, how would one be a Victorian? And she sort of starts you off with how you would wake up in the morning and go about your day. And how would this look like if you were poor, if you're rich? And she takes you through the different categories of a person's life and how this would look like on a daily basis in the Victorian period. But a lot of focus comes back to clothing because they were a huge part of Victorian society. Very indicative of class and mobility and anything in between. Each piece of clothing was, in a way, kind of like a work uniform where it not only put you in your place on the social ladder, but it also gave you a job role. And she kind of dives into this deeply. I really enjoyed it, and so did Natalie. The only thing that I would say kind of upset me slightly, but I mean, this is just kind of in general. Whenever people talk about the Victorian period, they always just say Victorian and brush it all, like the entire century, with the same brush. And if you were to do that for the 1900s, for example, could you imagine if someone said, think of like the 1990s where you have the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and the 1950s with like Marilyn and Elvis, and the 1920s with the flappers, and imagine trying to put all of that in the same category and just say the 20th century. It would look very odd, and the fashion is different, the moral code is different. And I find that in nonfiction books about the Victorian period, this tends to happen where everything is just Victorian, but it's a very broad term for a very long time. And the last book that I buddy read was this chunky biography, James Tiptree Jr.'s biography. And it's written by Julie Phillips. Both Rachel and I thought that Tiptree's life was way more exciting and adventurous than the biography it got. It was almost as if her life events were pulling the entire weight of this biography because it's written in this very dry style, and you feel like the author's putting all these like neat little boxes and definitions and categories, and then just dumping information in them as she goes along. Whereas Tiptree herself has traveled done all kinds of things. I honestly expected someone different. Based on what I know about her and her work and what we learned in September while reading the letters to Tiptree, I expected a complete recluse. Like, I expected a hermit. I expected someone who'd never got out of her house. I expected someone who was a lot like Emily Dickinson. And instead, what I got was this kind of Jane Goodall figure, who just goes out there and explores and learns. She was very into, like, exploring basically, and she would love going outside and seeing all of like the stages of her life and just how much she's accomplished up until starting to write. And then of course that part was the most interesting because you get to see her kind of writing and being secret and dealing with her identity because she was published as a male name and a lot of people thought she was a male because she wrote this very like pure sci-fi, and her short stories and her two shorter novellas are just phenomenal, and I would highly recommend you read them. But she wrote to a lot of people as well in her lifetime. She was in touch with Ursula K. Le Guin and other people in the sci-fi world, but no one really knew who she was for a long time, and she also struggled with depression a lot up until the very end where she killed herself. Again, I wish the biography would have been told differently. It's funny because I read one great biography this month, and kind of contrasting this with Wagamese's own autobiography, he like kind of chose to focus on the heart and those like heartwarming moments amongst all the details. And this book was kind of like all details and lacking heart. And other than that, I read three books, which I will mention on the next Death Shelf video, mainly because they're all kind of about death or death related. Two of them are kind of death and comedy, and one of them is very specific to Iceland. So I will check back in with a Death Shelf video very soon. I just have to read like three more books so I can have like a decent bunch. All right, so those are all of the books I've read in the month of November. I hope you had a great reading month, and I will see you in my next video. Bye!